Bom dia a todo mundo. Good morning, everybody. Thank you very much for coming. It's time we start this conference on frontiers of mathematics. The occasion for this conference is the fact that the executive committee of the International Mathematical Union was meeting in Rio in the last 2 days. Actually, I told the EC that this was probably the third meeting of the IMUEC in Rio, but I just learned it's the fourth. There were three previous meetings here. Anyway, we are equally happy and honored that the EC chose Rio to meet for their 2012 annual meeting. And then we decided this would be a great occasion to ask the EC members to give lectures, and so that's how this conference came about. And we are particularly happy that Ingrid Dobschies agreed to give the initial lecture. Ingrid doesn't need an introduction. Besides being the president of the International Mathematical Union and the recipient of several awards and distinctions, the latest of which was published yesterday, browsing the internet, I found that yesterday she got a prize from the American Mathematical Society. She's an extremely distinguished applied mathematician with very broad range of research interests. And today she'll be speaking on independent component analysis and functional magnetic resonance imaging. Ingrid, please.
Well, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. And this is truly a frontier of mathematical research, in the sense that it's the result of mathematicians thinking about issues that really were outside mathematics. But let me tell you, first of all, this is, as the first page indicated, the result of a collaboration with quite a team of people. And they are of very different directions. So the first three people are in electrical engineering. Then there was one of my students who obtained a PhD in applied mathematics. Kim Dardenne has a PhD in psychology, and this was part of her. Then there was a professor from chemistry. And the two main co-PIs on this were Jonathan Cohen, who is a medical doctor specialized in psychiatry. He has a PhD in psychology, and so it's what in a medical school is called an MD-PhD. I mean, like one expression like that. He's the director of the Princeton Institute for Neuroscience, and this whole project came about. It's work I did while I was at Princeton. I'm now at Duke University. And it came about because soon after he joined Princeton, fleeing Carnegie Mellon, because actually Jonathan Cohen was looking for a university with an interest in neuroscience, but that did not have a medical school, because he wanted to not be always pressured to look at clinical issues. He was interested in the functioning of the normal brain. So he came into my office and said, we have these problems, these signal analysis problems, and we need you to apply wavelets to them. And I said, wait. I mean, wavelets are not a silver bullet. I mean, I first have to really understand your problem. And I actually was very grateful that he and people from his team invested quite a lot of time in talking and explaining and answering questions. And then when we thought we had understood, but in fact we hadn't, rectifying our misunderstanding and so on. And out of that grew a weekly seminar that is actually, even though I now have left Duke, still going on, and it's been going on for the last 6 years, which was a Friday afternoon seminar, because that was when everybody was kind of winding down, so we were all free. And and most of our students did not want to meet with us Friday afternoons, and so that's why we had time. On mathematical and signal analysis methods for neuroscience. The other co-PI is Jim Haxby, who was then at Princeton, has since moved to Dartmouth. He is a PhD in psychology and is the director of cognitive neuroscience at Dartmouth. And he was the originator for a very crucial experiment on storage in the brain of visual data. We'll revisit that. Okay, so a little bit about fMRI, functional magnetic resonance imaging. Just a little aside, MRI used to, when I was much younger, called nuclear magnetic resonance. And then almost immediately the doctors realized that this nuclear thing in there was going to frighten lots of people, and it was renamed. I mean, they were just, the resonance was really the nuclei of the atoms, just as I had before. The physics didn't change. It had nothing to do with nuclear energy, of course. It was not fission or fusion, but it became magnetic resonance imaging, fMRI. The F stands for the fact that you want to look at function. So you probably all, and in fact the images you see here, except for the color, are standard magnetic resonance imaging. You all have seen these pictures, these beautifully crisp pictures of a knee or an articulation or the brain and so on. Those are pictures that are anatomical pictures, that's to say they're pictures in which you want to capture a tissue or organ or bone without fleeting temporal phenomena. And typically they take an exposure of about 10 minutes or so, and they can be beautifully crisp. What you do in functional magnetic resonance imaging is you want to actually see a way the brain works. So typically you get stimuli and that give you brain activity. So the stimuli have a temporal profile, and the brain activity will not really have that same profile, but will have a temporal evolution that is follows closely that temporal profile, and will also have a spatial location. I mean, some areas of the brain will be involved in that task and others will not. So coarsely speaking, you ask somebody to think of something and you want to see them think it. Now, you can't ask them to hold that thought for 10 minutes. I mean, it doesn't work that way. I mean, maybe you can, I can't. You have to do this with very short temporal resolution. And the result is that the spatial resolution is horrible. And so they work with extremely noisy signals. And that's why they need very sophisticated techniques in order to extract those. Typically, of course, your brain is not just doing the one task that is assigned. Typically, you do many things. I mean, your brain is also governing all the automatic functions of, I mean, breathing and so on. But also, it's very hard to, even if you concentrate, not to have other processes going on in your brain. I mean, you might think of the shopping you still have to do, or the interesting soccer game that is coming up that evening. And so there's a lot going on in your brain. And so the signal that you measure is noisy because of the high temporal resolution you must have, but also is a superposition of all these different temporal and spatial things. So that's what's called the general linear model. Of course, usually, I mean, since these are all activities, things in your brain, nothing is linear in life. So already assuming that it's a superposition of these different components is an assumption, but it works remarkably well. So in the regime where we work, where these experiments work, this linear superposition is generally accepted and works well. Okay, so you have your observation, and from that you want to extract the one activation map related to the task, because you want to find out where what is doing something in your task. Actually, this is only the beginning. What people really want, really are interested in, and we won't be getting to that in this talk, is see which different centers are acting in a task and which take over. I mean, they want to see, so for instance, one experiment that is a standard psychology experiment is called the Stroop test. In the Stroop test, you're asked to look at the words red or green. So without telling you beforehand, you will be shown a flash of the word red or the word green. Now, the color in which this will be printed is either red or green. It need not be the same as the word. So you can have red printed in green and green printed in red, but it's not always that way. I mean, and it's random. And just after you've seen that, you will get a cue, so the stimulus disappears, and you will get a cue that tells you whether you should respond the word or the color you have seen. So you have to keep in mind. And so it's a complicated task. And in fact, when the color in which the text is printed is different from the word you've seen, so when you've seen red printed in green, for instance, there's another center of the brain that has to come in that resolves conflict. I mean, conflicting information, it has to sort out. And that becomes active when the cue, when it's shown you what you have to answer, the color or the word. So people are interested in much more sophisticated things within the brain. But typically the activation mask is this map AJX may be more complex. And so we may even have several different components depending on time. But let's not even worry about that. Let's just think for the moment about a simple time task and one activation mask that is not going to depend on time for that task. So in order to get this signal out very cleanly, what is done in practice is that the task is repeated many times and with a very characteristic time paradigm. So typically, you're shown you'd have to do the task a certain time, and then you have a rest period. And then you have a certain period of task, and then rest, and so on. And it's because the task is being performed with a very characteristic boxcar function with periods of rest and so on, that you then take out of this whole signal, this very noisy signal that you measure, the thing that correlates best with that time profile, and that reduces a lot of the noise. Of course, that makes it harder already for very complex tasks to do something. Also, there is an habituation that happens, which is not part of what you really want to measure. So people really would like to be able to extract this, you are getting this reduction when you do the projection on the function in time, because you assume that thinking about shopping and soccer games and so on typically has a time function that is on average orthogonal to the task function. But you would like to do it without this projection. And the problem is that you have f of xt, you have that it is a superposition, very noisy, of product of such factors, and you want to extract the components. What was being done when Jonathan Cohen came to see me was that people had recently introduced what's called independent component analysis to analyze this. Okay, so let me tell you about independent component analysis. If you have a function that is written as a sum of products of a pure time function and a pure spatial function, there are of course zillions of ways you can do that. In fact, you can take your favorite orthonormal basis of functions in time and expand this function, spatial function of x and t into that, and you will get coefficients that depend on x. You can take your favorite basis in x and do the same, and you will get. So there are tons of ways. So saying that I want this kind of decomposition is not a well-posed mathematical question. So of course you need to impose additional conditions. And one condition that is imposed by people who use what's called independent component analysis is independence. So where does that come from, ICA? It really comes originally from what's called the cocktail party problem. In the cocktail party problem, you are given the kind of the audio signal that you would have when you are at a cocktail party. I mean, conversations going everywhere and reverberating and immense noise and so on. But nevertheless, unless it's really a terrible room or there's really enormously loud music playing, you are pretty good at hearing, among all that sound, the conversation you are having with people next to you. You can even, and I'm sure we've all experienced that, if there's a conversation of a little group standing close and you pick up a word that cues you in that they might be talking about something that you find really interesting, you might even for a moment concentrate on another conversation. So we are very good at, in noisy circumstances, picking out a piece of spoken, I mean, one spoken voice among many. So here is that rendered, I mean, so I want to show to you how we can view this as an independent component analysis. So here I have two signals that that an audio signal, very, very much stretched. We're looking here at a very short, at microseconds of speech, of two different speakers. So independence, what you do is you say, well, imagine that I take, and here I've highlighted it with this purple box, that I take only the place where one of the speakers, instead of going over the full range, goes over a certain sub-range. And I have identified the intervals in time where that happens. And I then take those intervals of time and I look at the other speaker and I look at what the variation is of the other signal during those intervals in time. And here you see that the variation of the other signal during a restriction on a sub-range of the first speaker is more or less the full range. Meaning, in the statistical sense, these signals are more or less independent. I mean, conditioning on values of one, the other one is behaving statistically the same way as before. And so you can make an assumption of independence, and then saying that you have independence and treating the whole thing as stochastic processes helps you in making the decomposition. And ICA does a reasonable job of decomposing in the cocktail party problem, but it is not really the best state-of-the-art method. I mean, there are better methods that can be achieved by using particularities of what speech signals are, and it is very likely that we, in solving the cocktail party problem, in which we are still at this time much better than any automated methods that we have come up with in high noise, that we do need to use a different thing than just independence. Anyway, so that's what the independent component analysis is. So the idea is that if you have a function of time, then ICA will produce, if you tell it, I want to find so many components independent of time, it will give you these components. And then you can put some normalization conditions on it, because of course you can otherwise change the amplitudes as you wish. So you can write it as a linear combination of normalized independent components, and you need many samples in order to be able to do that, because you need to condition on, typically, I mean, that's not how the algorithms work, but you need many samples in order to, even the way the algorithms do proceed it, you need many algorithms. You need many samples. Now, in functional magnetic resonance, they have a whole lot of X's. The X stand for voxel, which is like a three-dimensional pixel, and so they have a great many of those. They have 60,000 easily. And they're getting better because we're getting stronger, finer resolution these days. We are the most resolving magnetic resonance imaging, well, functional magnetic resonance imaging is now going at less than, I mean, a millimeter or less than a millimeter. And so what that means is that we actually are starting to have several voxels in the thickness of the cortex. But I mean, I'll come back to that. But so in time, however, I mean, the time resolution, remember I said, was very bad. The way magnetic resonance imaging works, functional magnetic resonance imaging works for the brain is, in fact, we do not really measure, they do not really measure, I don't measure anything, but they don't really measure the activity itself. What happens is that, and we have only recently, they have only recently started to understand why that is happening. What happens is that when a piece of the brain starts working, thinking, it gets a supply of more oxygenated blood. I mean, so, and that happens just fractions of a second, I mean, later. But it takes a little while for that to get there. And so you have an increase, and then it stays up a little bit, and then it goes down again. So you have this, what they call the BOLD function, the oxygenated and so on blood, the O is for oxygenated, the rest I forget. And so, that means that you have this BOLD function, and also you have all these down periods. And so even if you work very carefully, you have hundreds of samples at most in time because of the bad resolution you have. That's not enough to do independence. So what they do in practice is that they decompose in space using the independence paradigm. That's called spatial. If you do independence in time, that would be called TICA, time-independent component analysis. But they have too few samples to do that because of the mechanics of it. So, and also, even if you do, I mean, as I said here, if you do a 30 to 60 minute session, you have a few hundreds of time samples. 60 minutes in an MRI machine, in an fMRI machine, is a lot. I mean, it's virtually impossible to really stay concentrated on task. And if your subject doesn't stay concentrated on task, the quality of your signal becomes much worse. So typically a session of 20 minutes is the best to get good quality. So in practice, they will do the analysis on the spatial variable because they have so many more samples. And they call that spatial ICA, SICA. So from now on, I will really be talking about spatial ICA because that's what's used in practice. Fine. But let's go back to what it means. We had these different AJX and independent component analysis. Can you really think of these as independent? I mean, so we are now at the stage where we were after a couple of weeks of my talking with the people from functional magnetic imaging. And I said, come on, I mean, it's impossible. Look, if you have look at two different functions that we might be looking at, they're happening in different places. The highlighted thing in red and yellow are examples of such activation. I mean, they're not independent. I mean, one lives where the other doesn't. I mean, it's highly correlated. I mean, certainly if I condition on one being certain value, the other one is zero there. I mean, so how can it possibly work? So my first reaction was, I mean, you must be misguided. I mean, it doesn't work. I mean, come on. And so we said, well, let's test it. I mean, people have been using it and doing things with it, but let's try to find a case where we know that we are extracting with the other paradigm, so with projecting on a time function, we're extracting some really interesting signal, and let's see whether we can extract that same reality, the same phenomenon with independent component analysis. And this is where this very seminal experiment of Jim Haxby comes in. So let me first describe you that experiment and then tell you how we exploited it. So I'm describing here our journey of trying to, so I felt I was doing a mathematical reasoning on things that were completely outside mathematics in order to put my finger on what I could actually help with. And as I said, I was really fortunate in that people were willing to listen to me and accommodate me. And so we did experiments with functional magnetic imaging that normally would not have been interested to psychologists. They didn't lead to psychologically interesting conclusions. They just led to mathematical conclusions. So here's the experiment. So this is now an experiment that is 6 or 7 years old, so it's no longer, it's considered old and well established in these circles. People have been very interested in how information about different categories of objects are stored in the brain. And at the time, now partly because of this experiment, this is no longer believed in that way, but at the time people thought that this would be very localized. And Jim Haxby wanted to think of a way in which to test whether indeed things were that localized. Now remember, we're talking about very difficult to measure and very noisy signals. I mean, it's not just a question of saying, think of a house and something lights up, and then think of a monkey and something else lights up. So you have to be think of sophisticated ways. So what he did was the following. He had stimuli, faces, houses, cats, bottles, scissors, shoes, chairs, and random jumbles. And he would, he looked at a particular area of the brain that is part of the visual cortex, and he would look at, in this area of the visual cortex, he would look at, which was all activated by this visual task. The task itself, oh yes, I should say that. So the task itself was a task in which, as typically in these experiments, you're given a stimulus, rest, stimulus, rest, stimulus, rest. During the stimulus period, you would see several images within your category. The task you had was not to think, this is a house or this is so on. You would be show every time that you would have to say whether the second one of a pair of images was the same object but seen from a different angle or not. So the task was always the same, regardless of what category you were thinking of. So that you want to keep everything as much similar as possible. So we were not looking at a task being processed. That was elsewhere in the brain. We were looking at what is being read from the image, and do we read it differently for houses or for chairs and so on. So the task was always the same, and it was a one-back task, so always for a pair looking at the previous one and answering that question. And so you had to stay on task, you had to keep looking at this thing, and you were doing things and so on, but what was being measured was how you stored that. Okay, so then in that part of the visual cortex, they were measuring areas. So that visual cortex, all these, you had all these voxels that played a role in storing, in examining the visual data. And then for every voxel, Jim Haxby determined whether it was most responsive to houses or to chairs and so on. So he gave a label to every voxel, which was the dominant label for that voxel. I mean, it might play a role in other things too, but you never knew, it might be noise and so on. So everyone got a color. And then after that, he did the experiment after he did that, every voxel was given a color. Then he did a new run in which the task was the same, but of course with different objects. And he would check whether by seeing what voxels lighted up in the task, he could predict from the brain data, from examining just the observation, whether the subject had been looking at houses, chairs, and so on. And so what is shown here on the left is a visualization of that experiment. So within class, I mean, so you have here the labels, and you see the diagonal is when you stay within class. The correlation within class was typically much higher and positive than outside class. I mean, so this is because the things are so noisy, and if he had had only one category, it wouldn't have been significant. But over all these, it was a very significant result over the. Okay, but for the moment, we've just seen that indeed the visual cortex stores, I mean, distinguishes things and has areas that are more specialized in some than others. Then he did a new experiment. So imagine that I had the areas for faces and houses that I found in my previous experiment. Then I would now do a new experiment in which I only show faces and houses. But I use only voxels that I have labeled as non-face, non-house voxels, so that were most important for other things. They were specialized in other stuff. And I do the experiment again. And I try to predict from the other ones whether you were looking at faces or houses. And to the great surprise of the whole community, the prediction accuracy went down from maybe 95% to 92%. So you could almost as accurately predict from the observation of brain data whether you were seeing objects that you were not specialized for in that part of it. So this was an experiment that made a lot of noise when it was done. But we were using it just as a kind of ground truth. We were saying, look, in that data set, and this is one of the reasons it's so important for data sets to be available, I mean, because then you can test completely different things with them. On that data set, there is ground truth in there that has this information in it. Can we, I mean, if what the psychologists were telling me, spatial ICA really works on their data, it should be able to extract this as well. And I said, it won't work. I mean, it won't work because spatial ICA shouldn't work. I mean, there's no independence. And here, clearly, we're also talking about something where there's not really independence. I mean, we have spatial exclusion. And so we did the experiment. We did an ICA analysis on the data. And the idea of why ICA analysis so if we had truly independence, the idea of why ICA analysis might work, I mean, so I made these little diagrams. So a lot of work as a mathematician talking to people who don't have a big math background. I mean, the first thing that, and I knew that before we started, is that it's not because people don't put their thoughts in formulas that they don't think very precisely. Actually, that's what I learned working with these psychologists who were experienced in designing experiments. That in fact, and that's why when you write a paper with them, it's really every word is exactly considered. I mean, they try to write as precisely as we would write in formulas. I had never appreciated that. I mean, that they really put this incredible precision. So a lot is spent in making diagrams in order to communicate precise things without. If you write a formula, they're lost. I mean, they have this formula phobia, but diagrams work. So the idea was, I said, look, what is going on in this study is that imagine that you have these four different functions, and what Haxby was doing was for each of these functions, I have here these four colored functions. For each of them, I have marked on the x-axis where that function is dominant, and so you can look at a place where the black and the red functions are dominant, but clearly the green and the blue functions are still different there. So we decided to repeat the experiment with ICA and did a decomposition of the data. The first thing was that it turned out that if we just worked with the data as it was not possible to extract the different categories. So what we did is we made of the composite runs. So yeah, the experiment, when it had been done in practice, had been given intervals with faces, and then intervals with bottles, intervals and so on, and even the order in which things had been done had been randomized. So what we were asking our algorithm to do was actually to extract two different things. We were asking it to extract also these different activation functions from these runs of in time. And that it wasn't good enough to do, partly because we didn't have enough samples. So what we did is we actually, because there were these periods of rest for everybody, we made big composite runs of only faces, in order to extract a face function. And then we made a composite run of only bottles, extract the bottle function and so on. But then that was how we were going to extract, with independent component analysis, the activation functions, splitting that, the task function, from all the rest, from thinking about shopping, soccer, breathing, and so on. Once we had them, we had different activation functions for the different categories. And then we did all this via a wavelet analysis, because the idea was that that spatially these functions have peaks, and that's where of course they dominate, but they also have a behavior in space that has features in them, but that are not as dominant. And that behavior you can still extract. And if you do a wavelet decomposition, it might still be much more concentrated than in the spatial domain. So we did it via wavelets. So they were right. In the end, we were using wavelets, even though we were now 6 months in the whole discussion. And so we ended up with wavelets. And Jonathan Cohen said, you see, I told you. I mean, but anyway. So we extracted the component, and we then analyzed the data again. And so here you have a composite of the analysis as it was done by Jim Hagsby, and then the analysis as we did it with independent component analysis, spatial independent component analysis. And the results were not as good. So the main thing to recognize is that every red peak is now accompanied by an orange and a yellow peak. Orange and yellow are what you get for two different algorithms for independent component analysis. One is called InfoMax and the other is called FastICA. These are the two algorithms that are used for brain fMRI. Okay, so what strikes is that the orange peak is not always the same as the red peak. Actually, occasionally it's even bigger. The yellow is not as striking, but in both cases, they instead of having a 95% or 96% accuracy, dropping to 92, we dropped to maybe 88%. I mean, so the phenomenon was still there. I mean, the phenomenon that Hagsby had become famous for with his experiment was still there. Spatial ICA was capturing it, even though it shouldn't have. I mean, we have no independence whatsoever. I said, come on, this is impossible. We did it again, and so on. It was there. So it works. Yes. But how can that be? I mean, as I said, it shouldn't. I mean, I was really surprised. I mean, and then I said, well, something must be going on here, which is really interesting to understand, but that is beyond just the principle of independent component analysis. So. And that's when it became interesting to actually look at what the algorithms were that they were using. I mean, so I said Informax and Fast ICA, what are they doing? And I said, first, let's see if we take completely random data. I mean, not random data, let's simulate the data. Data where I control, where I know what is there. I mean, where I don't have to go via a ground truth experiment with correlation and so on in order to know that there's information I can get, and then let's make a simulated thing very simple and control. So what we did is we made an experiment on something square, and Jonathan Cohen said, now I know she's a mathematician, he says, she's drawing a square brain. But I mean, of course it doesn't matter because we looked at the voxels independently. But so we were looking at a square and we were going to put two different domains in there that would give us two different activations. And if you have truly independence, so what we would have random behavior and then a different random behavior on a subdomain. If you have true independence, then the behavior on the overlap, if the overlap, yes, so if the area of the overlap, the ratio of the area of the overlap to a rectangle is the same as the area of the overlapping rectangle to the whole, you will truly have independence, I mean, spatial independence. And so if that's not the case, then you have a deviation from independence. So the idea was that we would use two different components, and you see them pictured here at the top, and we would see whether we could indeed extract them from a superposition. So the only difference, so we did the experiment twice, once with the same probability distribution functions and one with slightly different ones. So we did two experiments. And we also did the experiment with different positions of the rectangles, where they had less overlap or more overlap. And we always give into the algorithm two mixtures. I mean, since we wanted two things to get out, you had to put as many things in as you wanted to get out. So we put in two mixtures. The algorithm did not know what the mixture matrix was and had to get us back, because of independence, the two components. And so the mixtures that it would get would be these two, and clearly you see the two components stand out as kind of ghost-like on top of the background, and we wanted to get them out. So if the PD, if you made a perfect fit between the probability distribution functions that were really there and parameters that you had to put in that guessed it, then indeed you could get out these different components. Both with Informax and with Fast ICA. If the components were not independent, so the overlap of the rectangles was not so that you had independence, you were still getting them out perfectly. If you had truly independent components, so true independence, but the PDFs, probability distribution functions, had out parameters that were not well matched, then you see in the little insets, you see what we got out in the different experiments, and you see that the algorithms did not unmix. So you were giving it not optimal match of probability distribution functions, which certainly in experiments we wouldn't get. Independent, truly independent components, and they weren't getting them. And so, summary of the results. If we had truly independent components, and there was a slight mismatch of PDFs, we were not seeing them. However, if the components were not independent, but we were guessing the PDS pretty well, then we were distinguishing them. So something was going on. I mean, we could get, even when they were not independent, this algorithm, assuming independence, was getting things out. We actually did, we said, come on, what's going on here? So we, in those two special cases, to distinguish those two special cases, we actually then, I said, are Informax and FastICA the only algorithms that are using? And I said, no, there's a lot of independent component analysis. So in fact, we have here this algorithm that is much more sophisticated and that learns, I mean, machine learning was coming up. I mean, this is a while ago. I mean, now there's much more development there that learns probability distributions as you go. And so we use that as well. And so then we tried it on those two simulated experiments, and we found that in the case where Informax and FastICA were failing on truly independent components, the PDF learner was learning them and could separate them. So that's the top. The right column gives, shows you perfect separation with the PDF learner and not with Informax FastICA. The bottom shows you the case where things are not independent. The rectangles have been moved. In fact, in this case, they have no overlap. FastICA and Informax were doing it well. But the much more sophisticated ICA algorithm, the PDF learner was not. You see clearly ghosts. One in the first component, you see a ghost of the second component. It's not doing a good job. So the sophisticated algorithm was doing what I would predict an independent component analysis algorithm would do. The independent component analysis algorithms that they were using for brain fMRI were doing something else. I said, yes, but if it's doing something else, I mean, then of course, I mean, I told you so. So we actually did many experiments. We did it with rectangles of different sizes and overlap, so with a whole lot of different translations. And here on all these graphs, I'm showing you the average behavior, the quartiles. I mean, the distributions were very non-Gaussian, so I showed quartiles and extremes rather than standard deviations. And below the green line, things were always clearly separated, and above the red line, things were clearly not separated. We were judging by eye, so it's not completely. So we did it for small rectangles, big rectangles, huge rectangles. And something very interesting came out, namely that the size of the rectangles mattered a lot, more than the independence. Well, we already were aware that independence was not the important thing. But Informax and FastICA behaved very differently. Actually, FastICA was, if you had to judge by closer to being truly independent, FastICA was better at that than Informax, as you can see from these graphs. I mean, for instance, the middle graph, and also it's especially in the middle graph. So how did I interpret? And remember, FastICA was, I mean, I didn't say it then, but was the algorithm that did less well on the Haxby test. Informax did better. FastICA did less well. FastICA is closer to truly independent than Informax. So again, this deviation from independence. So they can fail to separate independent components when the circumstances are not ideal. And when are they ever? But they're better at identifying well-separated and sparse components. Okay. Indeed, when you have little rectangles, you're looking at very sparse components. A big rectangle is not sparse, many voxels. So in wavelets, we have been using wavelet analysis on the Haxby experiment because we were trying to concentrate things. In wavelets, something that is smooth with certain peaks will be much sparser than in the voxel domain. So what was happening was really that, so what this study showed was that, and we did other studies and so on. The whole thing was published a few years ago in PNAS, so you can find it there. And it's, since it's a few years ago, it's open access. What we found was that this mathematical way of trying to articulate what is going on, can we design an experiment to test that and so on, that Informax and FastICA have features in them, do have a way of trying to find independent component analysis that actually stresses, looks for sparse components rather than independent components. And that's why it was working. This was before the whole thing about compressed sensing. Now we're looking for sparse component everywhere. But so these were already showing that sparsity was much more important than independence. I mean, this article was, I received lots of mails of saying that I had misunderstood and so on and so on. And I mean, we had been very, very careful, so the result has stood. I mean, it's not that we misunderstood. But this was a first indication. Donohoe had earlier indications also. I mean, he has a paper on independent component analysis for vision, which people had hailed as being very important and showing that wavelets came out. And he had pointed out that, in fact, they were doing sparse analysis. They were finding sparse analysis that was important. So, and out of that thinking, the whole looking for sparse components, which is now a very big thing, and with compressed sensing and so on that's going on, is it had developed. But so, for me, this was a very... it was very hard to get these results published, because the way people in this community work is that they do an experiment and then they try to publish it. And so here we did, I mean, I've given you in detail one experiment with the simulation, but we did actually three different ones. Each one on their own made no sense whatsoever to the psychologists. Why would you want to do this? I mean, you don't learn anything new psychologically out of it. But they did make sense in this quest of the mathematical underlying guiding principles that you should then use in order to find better algorithms. And so this meant that you shouldn't use for ICA, you shouldn't try to make your ICA algorithms better, which is what people were trying to do and finding worse results, because it was not independence you were hunting for, but sparsity. And so together with all these different experiments and then the whole logic explained, they made sense. And so we made it one big paper and then it was fine. So I don't know how much time. Oh, I think I'm almost within time. This is, thank you.